Oh, hey, how's it going, everyone? Thanks for joining me on this amazing day. It is so beautiful right now. I am just soaking in the sun's rays and I feel awesome. I also feel awesome that you guys are able to join me on this nice, relaxing boat ride. Wow, like today, we got a special one for you. Today, we're gonna be talking about the indignation of Jesus. And what does that mean? What does indignation mean? It means to show anger or just resentment towards an unlawful or injustice act. And you might be wondering, like, why, Patrick, why are you talking about indignation on such a peaceful river? The crazy thing is, like, water is a lot like Jesus. Most of the time, Jesus was calm, he's collected, he spoke with compassion, with love. But there are times when he just, like water, just snapped and like a storm, just enraged and brought down the fury of this righteous indignation on people who did wrong in God's eyes. And so we're going to take a deep dive and look into the indignation of Jesus. Come with me now. So, to get a better picture of what this indignation of Jesus looks like, what this righteous anger of Jesus looks like, we're gonna take a quick stop and visit our buddy Douglas. I know you guys are very familiar with him. He's gonna talk to us a lot about what it looks like to have this righteous anger. So let's go visit Douglas really quick.
Is it ever a good thing to be mad? Hey guys, it's me again, Douglas. And today I want to talk to you guys about righteous anger, like a good kind of angry. And I wanted to talk to you about anger today because it seems like there is a lot of anger going around. There's a lot of angry Christians out there. And to be honest, there are kind of a lot of reasons for Christians to be angry. But I also feel like we can let that anger get out of hand. But you know, it seems like anger should be wrong, right? But we know anger in itself isn't wrong because Jesus was angry. Jesus was really angry. Yeah, there's a story in the Bible where it talks about a time when Jesus got, you know, honestly more mad than I've ever actually seen a person get. Maybe in movies, but not in real life. And I've always thought of Jesus as being very calm and very gentle, and he is a lot of the time, but there was this time in Scripture where he got real mad. See, Jesus came to the temple, and the temple was sort of like God's house. It was where the Israelites went, and they took their sacrifices, and they prayed, and they worshiped God there. And people would come from all over. You know, the Jewish people, the Israelites, they would come from all over the place to the temple, and they would make their sacrifices. Well, a lot of the times, the sacrifices were something kind of big, you know, like a sheep, or something really specific, like a bird, like a dove. And so the people who would come to make sacrifices didn't always bring the sacrifices with them. So what people were doing was they were setting up these stalls at the temple where you could buy what you needed to make your sacrifice. And because they knew people needed to make sacrifices and they knew that people were going to show up without what they needed, they were charging like a crazy amount of money and really kind of cheating people in God's house, which was like super duper offensive, like really messed up. And Jesus was furious. The Bible says he was throwing tables and kicking people out, and he even made a whip out of cords, and he was whipping people and getting them all out of the courts because what they were doing was so, so wrong. But sometimes I think people use this as an excuse, right? They use this story as an excuse to be angry and to be mean. Anger is not a bad thing in itself, just a dangerous thing. You know, there's a verse in Ephesians where it says, in your anger, do not sin. It doesn't say, in your anger, stop being angry. It says, in your anger, do not sin. And, you know, anger is an emotion, and emotions, for the most part, are not right or wrong in and of themselves. It's all about what you do with them. So there are times where anger is good. And being angry can actually motivate you to do very important or very good things. It can give you that fire in the belly that you need to do what's right. But we need to be very, very careful not to let our anger control us. Because honestly, anger kind of feels good almost. You know, sometimes when people are angry, they're actually sad or scared. And they don't want to be sad or scared. They want to feel powerful, big, and strong, and dangerous. And anger can kind of help you feel that way. So sometimes people kind of get addicted to anger because it makes them feel powerful. It makes them feel kind of good, actually. But man, oh man, can it mess you up. So I think that there's three things that we need to remember when we are angry. One, don't let that anger control you. Work to control your emotions, which is hard, and don't let your emotions control you. For the most part, it's best to calm down before you act. Because for me, at least, I know that when I am angry, I'm also not at my brightest. I'm not thinking very clearly when I'm very angry. So it's best to calm down and think it through before you do or say something that you're really going to regret. And the thing about being angry is everybody's got a reason to be angry, right? But it's very rarely a good reason. And the second thing that you need to remember when you're angry is remember who your real enemy is, right? There will be people who make you mad, for sure. But those people, no matter how messed up they are not your enemy. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against Satan and the spiritual forces of evil. Satan wants you to be angry because he wants you to hate. And it's really, really easy to hate people that you're angry at. Which leads into the third thing, which is when you are angry, remember that you are not God. Okay, that seems like an obvious thing. Like, yeah, of course, Douglas, I'm not God. God is God, not me. It is not up to us to punish people for their sins. We do not judge the world. When people sin against God, it's not up to us to deliver payback. Vengeance belongs to God, not us. And you know, the truth is that the stuff that makes God happy should make us happy. And the stuff that makes God sad should make us sad. And the stuff that makes God angry should make us angry. But we got to remember that God is God, not us. And sometimes I feel like when we're angry, we feel like we need to put people in their place, right? We need to teach people a lesson. No, God is the teacher. God is the judge, not us. And so my challenge to you guys today is that in your anger, you would not sin. I'm not saying never be angry, because it can be good sometimes. There are plenty of things in this world that are terrible, that we should be angry about, that should get us up out of our chairs and drive us to action. But my challenge is that action would be good. Just because you're mad about something that is important doesn't mean that you can do things that are sinful. Don't let your anger control you. Don't forget who your real enemy is, and don't forget that God is God and you are not. It's okay to be angry, but let your anger drive you to do good things and not bad things. In your anger, do not sin.
Wow, it was great visiting Douglas. He knows his stuff. He really paints the picture of what these traits of Jesus really look like in action, in the real world. Now let's dive into the Bible. Like, we're going to take a look at a few stories about where Jesus exhibits this trait of righteous indignation. And so the first story you guys might be familiar with, it's where Jesus comes into the temple for the Passover, and he sees all these people selling and trading animals to make a profit. And this is Jesus' father's house. He's not too happy about that, and he shows it. And so we're going to take a look at a video that really illustrates what's going on. It really paints the picture for us in this story. Let's take a look.
During Passover, many people came to Jerusalem to worship at the temple. They would bring animals with them to sacrifice to God. They did this to ask forgiveness for their sins. Some of the temple officials were dishonest and greedy and saw a great business opportunity. They decided to start selling animals and many other things so they could make a lot of money. The temple became more like a flea market than a house of God. Jesus also celebrated the Passover and went to the temple with his disciples. When he saw how people were turning God's house into a marketplace, he became very angry and sad. The temple was supposed to be a place where God was worshiped, a place where people could pray to God. Instead, these people made a mockery of it. Jesus, filled with righteous anger, decided to put an end to it. He made himself a short whip, perfect for driving stubborn animals, and went inside to clear out all the animals and shopkeepers. Once inside, he grabbed tables and flipped them over. He kicked over benches and tossed aside stools. He freed the doves and set the goats and sheep free. The money changers and merchants were outraged. "What in the world are you doing? Who gave you the right to do this?" they shouted in anger. "Get out," Jesus shouted. "Don't turn my Father's house into a den of thieves," he said. Some of the merchants were furious at Jesus and could not wait to get rid of him. Jesus knew that they had wicked hearts and that they did not serve God. He wanted to teach them a lesson. When the people saw this, they were very surprised. "Who is this Jesus? With what authority does he do these things?" they said. So many of the lame and sick people came to Jesus, and he healed them. When the priests and scribes saw this, they were jealous and mad. Jesus was not afraid of them. He continued to do God's work, telling people about God's love and doing many miracles.
Wow, Jesus don't play no games when it comes to his Father's house. He making a whip, man, he's scattering, flipping tables. It's crazy, like, just to be able just to think about Jesus just going off like that. Like, Jesus, he's the guy who stands up for injustice, for unlawfulness. And we're going to take a look at another story where he exhibits that same exact tenacity for standing up for people who are mistreated. Now, if you guys want to turn with me to Mark 3, starting in verse 1, I'll give you guys a second to turn there. In Mark 3, it says, "Another time Jesus went inside the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, 'Stand up in front of everyone.' And Jesus asked them, 'Which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil? To save life or to kill?' But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts, said to the man, 'Stretch out your hand.' He stretched out his hand and it was completely restored." Wow, this righteous indignation of Jesus is incredible. Like, it's just so cool to learn about this side of Jesus. But how does this show for in our life? How can we actively pursue this trait of Jesus righteously in our own life? Well, let's take a look at a few scriptures that can help define the difference between righteous anger and self-righteous anger. Turn with me to Ephesians 4:26. It says, "In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry." And likewise in James 1, verse 19, it says, "My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires." So what does this mean? This means that there is such a fine line between righteous anger and self-righteous anger. As humans, we're not Jesus. We can't fathom what it's like Jesus was thinking about. Jesus knows our hearts. So it's a lot easier for us to become corrupted by our own selfish intentions. If I become angry about something, I want it to benefit me. I want to be angry because I want to be angry, not because I don't like what's going on or what's happening to others. It's because it's affecting me in a negative way. And I just want to be real with you guys. An example of that in my life was when my mom passed away. I was angry. I was furious. I was so frustrated with God for taking away my mom. Like, and what I didn't realize was all this was selfishness. This was my self-righteous anger, this self-righteous indignation on the way that I was treated. When if I would have turned it and flipped it into righteous anger, that would allow me to remember the passion that my mother had in her life. How she went out, she loved people, she was compassionate, she went out and made disciples. And I didn't realize that. And so now that I'm a lot more mature, I see that it's a lot harder to exemplify this righteous anger because I'm more thinking about what I want, what benefits me, what I'm angry about. So I hope you guys can also look at the second scripture we went over in James 1:19, where it talks about be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. It's because we're flawed, and if we're quick to listen, then we're able to cool off, to calm down, to catch our breath, to be able to come back and have a peaceful, loving conversation with whatever has angered us in the past. So, going forward, if you're ever feeling angry at something, like it could be a sibling, a friend, your parents, I want you guys to take just a deep breath and come back when you're ready to have to address it calmly, collectively, with love. Because that's how we move forward. That's how we reconcile with each other and love each other. I've enjoyed this time to be able to talk about the righteous indignation of Jesus. And I hope that we can just take this lesson and just apply it in our daily lives. Like, I love spending this time with you guys, on these Sundays. It's such a great opportunity just to learn and to grow together. And I hope you guys have a great rest of your Sunday and a great week. I'll see you later. Have a good one. Bye.